Welcome to the Radio 2 Piano Room, bringing you a host of the best loved pop acts, all performing with the wonderful BBC Concert Orchestra. Next up is one of the biggest selling superstars of the noughties and the 2010s, who has one of the most powerful voices going, bringing us one of her classic tracks, a brand new song, and a rocking cover of Whitesnake's Here I Go Again. It's Anastacia! Track is 20 years old next month. Can you believe it?
Just as old as me.
I'm not laughing. That wasn't a laugh.
It is hard to believe. It feels the same. It feels like home. And it was such a beautiful journey to actually make that song happen because of what I was going through to find such beauty in the darkness. It's not a happy song, but it is a happy song to have been able to approach your life and find a way to come out of the darkness.
When you have success like that, considering everything that you were going through, that must be a joyful moment, like you said, coming out of the darkness.
I would love to think that that's what I felt at the time. What I felt was nothing was good enough because I didn't know that I was in touch with what was good and what was bad. I was just trying so hard to be normal or be alive or be good. And, you know, you kind of go into your own terrible stuff in your head. So I don't know that I wish it wouldn't have been so that, because I was talking a lot in my head to myself, probably not as nice, because you got to get better. What happens? You don't want to lose everything. And just, you know, so I don't know. I just think I was spinning more than I should have. And now I don't.
Is that also because it took you, dare I say it in a polite way, it took you a while to get established because you were dancing, you were doing backing vocals, you never quit, you never give up on making it, and then when you found success, was there a moment of like, right, I'm here now, do I work harder or do I back off the gas a little?
No, I to be honest with you, I was collecting an unemployment check and I went on a TV show and they're like, we think you're amazing. And I was like, but you know, I was like, sure you do. And then they sign me and I'm like, well, that's nice. And you put out the first album and you're like, it's not gonna sell. And then you start seeing people know your song and I'm like, who are they paying? Why do these people know my song? It just was the non-believing it was happening. And then when it did happen, the pressure of, well, how do I make this happen all the time? Like, it's not supposed to happen. So now I have to like make product happen. This is like for real. It's not just me trying to make it happen. It's there.
Well, if that's the case, when you did find that success eventually, did you have a moment to celebrate or were you straight on to the next thing? Like you say, how do we keep this ball rolling?
Always to the next thing. I think I was always in it'll never happen in my head a lot because I got my first deal at 30. Like that is antique in our industry, you know, and they were like, she looks 22. So for everyone, I was 22 years old when I got signed. Lies. And, you know, and then hence the career continued. But I always felt that I had to try harder because I didn't know enough. I was old enough to know the business, but not old enough to know what I was getting into, you know. I was in bars and singing at weddings, you know.
But surely, tell us, when that first check arrived, did you treat yourself to something?
I don't even, to be honest with you, check. Like, it was so, I had to pay so many people back. I don't know when I actually did something that made me, oh, yes, okay, well, I will be honest. I went to Bergdorf Goodman. And that's a very expensive, that's like Harrods of New York. And I bought 3 pairs of shoes. And I went absolutely bonkers that one pair was $3,000. I thought I had bought a Ferrari. I was like, I'm never going to take them off. And then I brought them back.
You took them back?
I brought them back because I was like, who the heck needs to have $3,000 shoes? This is ridiculous. And they're not that comfortable.
That sounds like a huge punch in the face from reality.
Yeah. It was just kind of like, and it was the one that wasn't the most comfortable. So right. I was like, hey, now I'm too practical.
Yeah, good on you.
But now I buy a lot of things that are very expensive and very inappropriate, and I still own them. Thank you.
Well, bravo you. We've got the new album. We're going to talk about that a little bit later on. What are you going to perform for us now?
For the new album, there is a wonderful single. I absolutely adore it. It's called Now or Never, and it just is about, let's just, you can't wait. These days you gotta take it when you can take it, and you just can't have the fear that you have inside. Don't listen to the head, listen to the heart, and just go for it. If you fall, you fall, but get back up.
And I love the fact that you're so passionate about this track that we're giving you the gift of performing with the BBC Concert Orchestra, so this will make it extra special for you. So
this is amazing. Thank you guys.
We'll be right back. No One Ever, from your current album, Our Songs. And correct me if I'm wrong, I think I'm right, but they're cover versions of German songs. Is that right?
Absolutely. Those songs have never seen the light of English words. So no one has ever, outside of Germany or that knows German music, has ever heard that song. And I had an idea, somebody put a, you know, what they call in Germany, which is an Ohrwurm, which is an earworm. And it kind of was interesting to think that that's not necessarily music that transfers and goes to America or goes to Italy. And I thought, there's got to be great music over there. And I started just searching more for music. So the melody, the chords first, then I'd go to, well, was it saying? And I was like, ooh, I don't want to say that. And then, so I found songs that I felt connected to. And then when I write stuff, I write it like I write. So the song feels like a song that's originally mine because I like to write with metaphors and stuff, so.
Nice. And you went to Germany. You toured Germany last year along with the rest of Europe.
Yeah.
How was that?
It was great. It was great. It was an unexpected super success because I didn't think that my passion project of taking German songs and translating them into English would be something Germans really were wanting. Like it was like a desire, a missing piece of their wonderful puzzle. And they didn't either, but then once they listened to the album, they're like, holy, wait a minute, like, I love that song, but I love, like, it's this, I know it's the same song, but it's not, you know.
It shouldn't be good, but it is.
Yeah, it should not. We did not want that to be a good album, you know. So I was very, very blessed, you know. And it's wonderful to be able to sing it in every other country and have them get to experience beautiful new songs.
Awesome. Did you manage to spend some time in Berlin?
A lot. Why?
Did you go out when the sun set in Berlin?
Okay, why are you talking
about
this?
Because, in my opinion, it's the best party city in Europe.
Well, I'm not a party person. I know I sing these songs that like make you only be like, oh my God, get me another drink. But I'm so not the person to bring to a party. I'm the person to play at a party. But
well, I love the fact that you know what we do when we play your songs on the tables.
Exactly.
Going
That's
absolutely
the dance.
Nuts. Yeah.
I've created it.
No, we touched on it earlier. We touched about your drive for success and your don't quit attitude, which we absolutely love. We've got a clip because with all our artists in the piano room, we go into our archive. And this is an interview that you did in 2001 with Jules Holland on his later show. Just listen to this.
I didn't want to be a singer. I didn't.
What did you want to be?
An archaeologist.
You thought for a moment it was a good idea to do archaeology.
I was wearing glasses and, you know, I was a kid. You know, what do? You're not a singer if you're four eyes.
There you go.
Hey, God. How is I like, oh, my God. I sounded so young and stupid.
No.
Well, a little bit like, I am four eyes. It's true.
Did you study archaeology, though?
I didn't study it. Okay, this is where it came. It sounded really smart. I was starting to look for shells on the beach. Then the story was you could find a fossil and you could be an archaeologist. And I was like, I've got a trade. So like at five, I was like, it's going to happen. got the microscope, and then all I started looking at were dead bugs and seeing the hair on their legs. Okay, like, it didn't really turn out and span out to be, King Tut or any mummification, but, and then I realized you're alone in the dirt.
With a trowel.
So I just realized, and also I'm not smart, so that was that.
Are you into archaeology? Are you into the dinosaur hunting thing?
I'm not into it, but I'm just grateful that we do have the ability to have historical facts, and if people want to know them, they're there, and you can't refute it. That facts are facts. Some facts don't want to be believed, but I'm like, I see those bones, and they do not look like my dog. So I'm just going to say it's probably a dinosaur, you know.
We've got a voice note question from Lindsay.
Hi, Anastacia. Lindsay from Reading here. As someone who felt very conscious growing up of wearing their glasses, you made them cool. I just wondered if you had any glasses heroes growing up as well.
What a great question.
Oh, well, and I'm really glad that she said that because I have loved being a glasses wearer. And I think I want to say I really have to give him all the credit. Elton's records were in the house. He was wearing those glasses, like, and I wanted all of them, mind you. And when I was 6 years old, my mom said, "You're going to need glasses." She said, "I did this." You know, she was like not really expecting that reaction, but, and then she got me four pair, a black pair, a purple pair, a red pair, a clear pair, and I loved them ever since. But then I was asking for the one with the windshield wipers, and that was a little dramatic. So I never got those yet, by the way. Anyone wanting to pass me a pair when I'm walking in London? Need it sometimes.
Nice. Now, as always, the last track that we get everyone to perform is a cover version. I'm really excited. When I saw this one on the list.
Were you?
Oh, yes.
Oh, good.
Oh, yes. This is so good. You explain why you've chosen this, please, and then tell us what it is.
Well, I am a, I like classic rock. I like the vibe of it. I think I would have probably loved to have been a little bit delayed in where my music really sits in my soul. And I've covered a lot of rock artists, and I've covered a lot of their songs. And I wanted to really just also pay homage to the fact that I didn't want to pick a band that wasn't from yours truly, UK. So I decided for Whitesnake. I just thought, you know, and also I liked what it said. You know, it's just the words matter to me. When I write them, when I sing them, I have to believe what I'm singing. So, you know, it's just, here I go again. You know, that's the way it is, you know.
Amazing. Over to you.
But I do know where I've been, hanging on the promises of the songs of yesterday. When I made up my mind, I ain't wasting no more time. Though I keep searching for the answer, never seem to find what I'm looking for. Oh Lord, I pray, give me strength to carry you on, 'cause I know what it means to walk along the lonely street of dreams. Here I go again on my own, going down the only road I've ever known. Like a drifter, I was born to walk alone. Well, I made up my mind, I ain't wasting no more time. Just another heart and